In this video, we'll take a look at group homomorphisms and their properties. What exactly is a homomorphism? Well, we've talked about isomorphisms in the past, and an isomorphism was a mapping that was one-to-one and onto and preserved the operation. So a homomorphism simply preserves the operation. So it doesn't have the added properties of being one-to-one and onto. So really an isomorphism is just a special type of homomorphism. An isomorphism is a little bit stronger because it's one-to-one and onto. So again, we're going to call it phi, and phi is going to map from a group G to a group G bar. Now the kernel of the homomorphism phi, which we're denoting cur of phi, from a group G to a group with identity E bar. So we're just going to call it E bar so it's clear that E bar is an element of G bar, not an element of G, is the set of all of the X's. So we're looking at the elements of G that map to the identity in our homomorphism. So the kernel of the homomorphism is the set of all elements G that map to the identity under phi. For example, if we have an isomorphism, again, we've got some isomorphism that maps from G to G bar. The kernel of that isomorphism is going to be the trivial subgroup because it's one to one. So only one element is going to map to the identity in G bar, and that is the identity in G. So phi of E is going to equal E bar. So the kernel of phi is equal to just E. And again, that is because it is one to one. If we're looking at the mapping phi from Z to Zn, defined by phi of M is equal to M mod N, it's a homomorphism with kernel, the cyclic subgroup generated by N. So let's look at an example so this makes sense. Let's say phi is going to map Z, which is the set of integers, to the set of integers mod 3, Z3. Now, what is the identity in Z3? The identity is 0. So essentially we're saying phi of what values are going to give us 0 mod n? Well, we know that phi of 3 would give us 0 mod n, 0 mod 3, sorry, I should have used a 3 there. Phi of 6 is going to be 0 mod 3, and so on. So really any multiples of 3, and that's why we can say that it's everything generated by 3. Before we talk about the properties of homomorphisms, let's look at two examples to make sure we understand homomorphisms and kernels. So for our first example, we're going to define phi as a mapping from the general linear group of 2x2 matrices with real entries to R star. Remember that R star is just non-zero reals under multiplication. And the mapping is defined by phi of A is equal to the determinant of A. So remember, A is going to be some element that is in the general linear group. That's why we're using the capital letter because it's a matrix. And then the determinant of A is going to be some non-zero real. We're going to verify that this is a homomorphism. So step one, verify, and then determine the kernel. So step two, oops, change colors. Step two, determine the kernel. So when we're asked to verify a homomorphism, what they're asking us to do is verify that phi of AB is equal to phi of A, phi of B. So essentially they're saying, show that it's operation preserving, and then determine the kernel. Remember, we're looking for what elements are going to map to E bar, which is of course, whatever the identity is in G bar, which is the second group. But let's start with one. Show that phi of AB is equal to phi of A, phi of B in this example. So phi of AB, I'm going to use capital letters to denote that these are matrices. According to the definition that says phi of A is equal to the determinant of A, then phi of AB is equal to the determinant of AB. Based on the properties of determinants that we already know, we know I can rewrite that as the determinant of A times the determinant of B, again, based on properties of determinants. Well, the determinant of A can be rewritten as phi of A according to phi, and phi determinant of B can be rewritten as phi of B. So I have shown, based on properties and the definition of phi, that phi is a homomorphism. Now I want to determine the kernel. So the first step when you're determining the kernel is to identify E bar. So what is, that was horrible writing, but identify E bar. So essentially I'm saying in the second, or in the group that is being mapped to by phi, what is the identity? And so in this case, the identity is just 1 because it's under multiplication. So the identity is 1. So the question is, what matrices will map to 1 under phi? Well, thankfully, we actually know a special group called the special linear group. And we know that anything in the special linear group will have a determinant of 1. So necessary first step, identify what is the identity that we're mapping to, and then we find the elements that map to that. Let's do the same for our second example. So we're defining phi as a mapping from R star to R star. So again, non-zero reals under multiplication. Show that a mapping where phi of x is equal to x to the r, where r is some positive integer, is a homomorphism, and determine the kernel. So same thing. So first, show that the mapping is a homomorphism. So I'm going to let phi of AB would be AB to the r, according to our phi definition. According to properties of exponents, I can rewrite that as a to the r, b to the r. And a to the r, according to this definition, can be rewritten as phi of a, and b to the r can be written phi of b. So therefore, phi is a homomorphism. All right, now let's take a look at the kernel. So again, in R star, what is the identity? The identity is equal to 1. So what is going to map to 1? So again, we're saying some value to the Rth power. What's going to map to 1? So when R is even, what's going to map to 1? Well, the kernel of phi would be equal to to both 1 and negative 1. Because if I had 1 to the second or negative 1 to the second, both of those are going to map to 1. But when R is odd, the only thing that's going to map to 1 is just 1. Let's take a look now at some properties of the elements of homomorphisms. So just as we did with isomorphisms, we're breaking it out by properties of specific things. In this case, we're looking at the elements. So phi is a homomorphism from G to G bar. Phi carries the identity of G to the identity of G bar. So again, phi of the identity of G is going to be equal to the identity of G bar. Phi of g to the n is equal to phi of g to the nth power for all n and z. If the order of g is finite, then the order of phi of g divides the order of g. The kernel of phi is a subgroup of g. Phi of a is equal to phi of b if and only if the left cosets are the same. So these are cosets, a times the kernel of phi and b times the kernel of phi. So if those cosets are the same, that means they map to the same element and vice versa. And this last one's kind of hard to picture. It says if phi of g is equal to g prime, then the inverse of phi of g prime is equal to g times the kernel of phi. So I don't know about you, maybe that makes perfect sense to you, but for me, I needed an example to understand. So this example is using theorem 6 or property 6. So he says, suppose that phi is a homomorphism from Z30 to Z30. So phi maps Z30 to Z30. The kernel of phi is 0, 10, and 20. So here's my g, and here's my g bar, and it doesn't matter that they're the same group. And we're saying that 0 and 10 and 20 are all members of the kernel. And remember, the kernel maps to the identity. So the identity in Z30 would be 0. Then it says phi of 23 is equal to 9. So that means 23 in G maps over here to 9 in G bar. So where am I going with any of this? Well, I'm trying to determine all of the elements that map to 9. That means we're finding the inverse. So we're finding phi inverse of 9. Now, according, that was a horrible phi. According to property 6, that tells me that that's going to be equal to g, which in this case is 23, which is the element we started with, and then times the kernel of phi. But remember, we're dealing with addition here. So this is actually plus the kernel of phi. Well, what's the kernel of phi? 0, 10, and 20. And again, we're adding in mod 30. So I'm going to end up with 23 plus 0, which is 23. 23 plus 10, which is 33, but that's 3 mod 30. And 23 plus 20, which is 43, or 13 mod 30. So again, the elements that map to 9 are 23, 3, and 13. Let's take a look now at some properties of subgroups of homomorphisms. So again, we have phi maps g to g bar, and we have h is a subgroup of g. So some of the properties, first, phi of h is a subgroup of g bar. So again, phi of h would be a subgroup of g bar. If H is cyclic, so these are all going to be talking about the structure of groups. If the subgroup is cyclic, then phi of H is cyclic. If H is abelian, then phi of H is abelian. If H is normal, then phi of H is normal. For 5, it says if the kernel of phi is equal to n, then phi is an n to 1 mapping from G to G bar. So we didn't specify this before, but we did look at an example when when R was even. We said the kernel was negative 1 and 1, and that's actually a 2 to 1 mapping. So the kernel has two elements, and it was a 2 to 1 mapping. But when R was odd, the kernel was just one element, and it was actually an isomorphism. For 6, if the order of H is equal to N, then the order of phi of H divides N. If K bar is a subgroup of G bar, so again, we've got G and we have G bar. So we're saying K bar is a subgroup of G bar. We've got a subgroup over here. Then the inverse of that, or preimage of that, is a subgroup of G, which means it maps back to some subgroup over here. And again, if K bar is a normal subgroup of G bar, then the inverse is a normal subgroup of G. And then if phi is onto and the kernel of phi is the identity, then phi is an isomorphism. So again, you would still have to prove that it's onto, but if you can show that the kernel of phi is E, then you would not have to show that it's 1-to-1. Since on the last slide, I just did a lot of basically reading of properties and didn't really get into how any of them applied, this is really just some application of some of those properties. So I've rewritten the property that it applies to here. So we're looking at four different properties. And for each of these, we're going to look specifically at the example where phi maps Z12 to Z12. So everything is in addition mod 12. With the identity in each of those groups as 0. And the mapping takes phi of x to 3x. So one property said if the kernel of phi was n, then phi is an n-to-1 mapping from g onto g bar. So what is the kernel of our mapping? The kernel of our mapping is anything in g, anything in Z12 that would map to 0. So what maps to 0? 0 maps to 0. 3 times 4 is 12, which maps to 0. 3 times 8 is 24, which maps to 0. And again, 0, 4, and 8 are all members of Z12, and they're all mapping to 0 in G bar, which is also Z12. But I couldn't use something like 12 in the kernel because 12 is not a member of Z12. And it's a 3-to-1 mapping. Next property, if H is cyclic, then phi of H is cyclic. So notice that 2 is cyclic. So the subgroup generated by 2 is cyclic. And phi of 2 is 0 and 6, which is also cyclic. If the order of H is n, then the order of phi of H divides n. So again, we're using 2. So the order of 2 is 6. And phi of 2 is equal to the order of 6, and the order of 6 is 2, because 6 plus 6 would equal 12, which is 0. So the order is 2, and the order of phi divides the order of 2. If k bar is a subgroup of G, then the preimage of k bar is a subgroup of G. So if we let k bar be 0, 6, which is a subgroup of G, Z12, subgroup of G bar, which also Z12, I just circled the wrong one, then phi, or the preimage of K bar, is all of these elements that are going to essentially map to 0 and 6. Up next, we're going to look at the first isomorphism theorem.